Hi, my name is Jordan Dean, and in this episode, we're up in North America, taking a brief look into the lives of the extremely abundant, formidable, and surprisingly ingenious wood ants. Wood ants cover the genus Formica, natively found almost exclusively within the Northern Hemisphere, with the richness of species fading out towards the pole and equator. These ants go by quite a few common names, the most widely used of which is the wood ant, which is derived from where they're usually found, in and amongst wooded areas. Although many species of Formica do quite well in more open areas too, like in grasslands, and even arid areas. So you might hear them also referred to as field ants. And yet another name they go by is the mound ant, or thatching ant, as many species form a large hill as part of their nesting structure. These hills are comprised of a mix of organic materials, such as soil, twigs, leaves, and pebbles. The ants meticulously search the surrounding area, gathering up anything they deem suitable. And one piece at a time, they carefully thatch them into their ever-growing piles. For the forest-dwelling species, there's virtually no shortage of adequate nesting material lying around in the undergrowth. So here, nests can reach massive proportions, known to get up to 2 meters in height. So what's the purpose of these monumental structures? Well, all that organic material works to capture in thermal energy, absorbing up heat much more quickly when compared to the more typical underground nests, in both direct sunlight and in the shade. And with the insulative properties of the materials, combined with some clever architecture, the ants are then able to retain and manage that heat over time, essentially building themselves an incubator. So how do they do it exactly? Well, if you look closely, you'll see all these little holes scattered across their mounds. These holes lead back through tunnels and passages into the heart of the mounds, acting not only as access points for the ants, but more importantly, as ventilation shafts. Each one is carefully positioned so as to control the flow of humidity and gases within, which in turn controls the internal temperature of the nest. The ants are constantly at work, shifting their substrate around so as to maintain their ideal conditions, which, once achieved, will drastically increase the ants' productivity and speed up the development of their brood. The construction of these mounds are especially useful in cooler regions, like up in the mountains, where every little bit of extra heat is crucial for the ants' survival. The most successful colonies will often place themselves southern facing, so as to take full advantage of the sun's heat. And they'll raise and broaden their nests as much as they possibly can, often building upon logs and tree stumps to give themselves a head start, and to act as a good foundation for their structures. Anything that threatens to block the ants' precious light cannot be tolerated, so the ants will actively chew apart the surrounding vegetation, slicing through their leaves and stems with the use of their powerful mandibles. And just to make sure they don't grow back, the ants will continually inject the plants with small doses of formic acid expelled from venom glands in their abdomens. Wood ants use their formic acid for more immediate threats too. If their nest is damaged by an intruder, within seconds, hundreds of ants will swarm out in defense, biting at them, creating wounds, and proceeding to fill those wounds up with a spray of their noxious acid. The ants also use their chemical weaponry, on the offensive too. Folding their abdomens under their bodies, they proceed to shoot out a string. Wood ants are mostly scavengers, but have no problems predating small invertebrates, overwhelming them with their immense numbers and aggressive nature. Rival ants are also dealt with accordingly. The smaller ant here is quickly secured and sprayed with formic acid until it's no more. Despite wood ants' offensive capabilities, they're generally more interested in sweet foods, with a large portion of their energy being derived from a symbiotic relationship with sap-sucking invertebrates like scaly bugs and aphids. The base of this flowering plant here is home to a herd of these little bugs, and the wood ants are their keepers. They sit amongst them, waiting patiently for them to excrete a rich honeydew, in which they then consume. Without the presence of the ants, these often defenseless little bugs become extremely vulnerable to predators. Like this ladybug here. Ladybugs love nothing more than snacking on these little guys. But when the ants are around, they're far from convenient prey. If they get too close, the ants swarm over the would-be predators, defending their herd with their lives. And, as a result, sometimes the ants return home with more than just a stomach full of honeydew. This particular nest is littered with the dead of all those ladybugs who ventured just a little too close to the unwelcoming farmers. Wood ants don't always rely on honeydew for a quick sugar fix, however. Sometimes they'll feed directly from the plants themselves, lapping up the sweet nectar found within many flowering plants. Unlike their relationship with the sap-sucking bugs, however, in most cases, only the ants stand to benefit from this exchange. The sweet nectar in which these flowers produce is intended to attract pollinating insects. Ants, unlike winged insects like bees and butterflies, don't make for great pollinators, only carrying the flower's sticky pollen over relatively short distances before falling or being stripped off by the ants, thanks to their excessive grooming habits. Ants, in general, are incredibly hygienic little animals, and they need to be. Because they nest within environments which are often warm and humid, and are constantly within close proximity of countless colony members, it makes their nests an ideal breeding ground for disease. If just one ant were to be infected by a harmful bacteria or fungi, it could quickly spread and spell doom for the entire colony. So it's vitally important that the ants not only carefully dispose of waste and keep their nest area clean, but keep themselves clean too. So ants will obsessively groom themselves. They do so by running their forelegs all over their bodies. These front two legs contain a row of minute, comb-like hairs, making them perfect for scraping off any contaminants, and thus reducing the chances of epidemics. And for further protection, many ants make use of their formic acid, spreading tiny amounts over them and their developing brood. Uniquely, wood ants have taken some extra precautions in cleanliness. Their solution is rather ingenious. What they do is scale up conifer trees and gather up fragments of their dried up sap, known as resin. This resin naturally contains antimicrobial compounds, which greatly inhibit the growth of harmful bacteria and fungi within wounded trees. So the wood ants carry these fragments back to their nests and disperse them throughout. And the resin continues on serving the same purpose as it once did for the tree, fighting off bacteria and fungi. But instead, it's now working for the ants. Every time an ant walks over the resin, it's essentially disinfecting itself. This practice of resin collecting is unique among wood ants. And what's more, is the ants can even enhance the resin's beneficial properties. They do so by treating it with their formic acid. Studies show that when deadly outbreaks do occur, colonies which have formic acid treated resin present within their nests have a much higher chance of both surviving and recovering from the ordeal. Colonies have been known to collect kilos of this sticky stuff, and it's easy to see why. It really is a perfectly evolved safeguard for the ants, improving their colony's longevity and subsequently their odds in producing reproductives, like this young queen ant here. It's summertime here in North America, and that means it's time for the wood ants to undergo their nuptial flights. This is where all the reproductive ants, known as alates, fly away from their nests to mate with foreign alates. The males, referred to as drones, have a very slender look, resembling more of a wasp than an ant. Their sole purpose in life is to simply mate with the winged females. After they've completed their task, they die, a short but productive life. The female alates, on the other hand, now becoming known as dealates, or simply queens, have a long and strenuous road ahead of them. Their goal is to find a suitable nesting site in which they can safely lay and tend to their eggs. At this point, they shed their wings, as they'll simply become a liability when they begin the digging of their underground chambers. Once they've settled into their new homes, they'll lay their eggs and simply sit there in solitude, waiting for them to develop into workers so they can form a new colony. But not all wood ants have such humble beginnings. Some species are known as social parasites. After their nuptial flights, instead of searching for a secluded spot and slowly founding a colony from scratch, what these queens do is seek out a small colony of another specific wood ant species. Once they find the right nest, they infiltrate, seeking out their queen and pacifying the workers with alluring pheromones as they go. Once the queen is found, amongst the confusion, the parasitic queen slaughters her, tearing the unwary queen apart with its specialized mandibles. Then she excretes a chemical signature, almost identical to that of the deceased queen, fooling the workers into believing that she is, and always has been, their queen. And so, the workers just blissfully continue on about their business, foraging, tending to the brood, and now, ignorantly caring for a foreign queen. Once the new queen's offspring begins emerging, the colony becomes a blend of two different species, working together as one. The parasites and the slaves. Eventually, only the parasitic queen's offspring is left behind, leaving no trace of the original colony. Often, however, once the parasitic workers have become abundant, they'll begin raiding other colonies for more slaves, forcing their way into their nests and capturing their brood, so as to build up the working force of their colony. So wood ants, they really are a sophisticated bunch. From their intuitive skills in architecture, constructing nests of remarkable scale and function, to their cunning as farmers, vigilantly tending to their flocks, to their insightful resourcefulness as chemists, using their formic acid to fight off threats, subdue prey, clean their young, and even to produce antibiotic concoctions. And finally, to their darker side of parasitism, forcefully infiltrating nests and deceitfully controlling foreign colonies, as well as raiding them for slaves. Truly fascinating. So what do you guys think of wood ants? Pretty incredible, right? Of all the ants I've been out filming, these guys seem to give me the most trouble. Getting close-up shots of their nests was far from easy. They weren't hesitant about biting anything that came near, getting at my camera gear, and occasionally me too. Their bites, in combination with their formic acid, is definitely worth avoiding. So don't be like me. If you come across these guys, give them some good distance. Speaking of keeping your distance, I wasn't just looking for ants on my trip. North America is home to some pretty incredible wildlife, and I was fortunate enough to encounter a great deal. Mountain goats? Bighorn sheep? Elk? Several black bears, and even a grizzly bear, which I was surprised to learn love eating wood ants. They'll sit by their nests and swipe at them, intentionally aggravating the ants, so as they swarm to the surface, the bears would lick them all up. Once they'd go through the first wave of ants, they'd swipe the nest again, and eat up the second wave of defenders, and so on, potentially sitting there hours at a time, swiping and eating. All these animal sightings, in combination with the stunning landscapes, made my trip a truly magical experience. And it was all made possible by you guys. By watching my videos, subscribing, liking, and all that, you provided me with the funding to get up there in the first place. For that, I'm incredibly grateful. So thank you guys all so much. Well, now I'm back home in Australia. Expect to see more DIY tutorials, colony updates, and some more documentaries like this one. Next one's going to be on what I now see as the wood ants of Australia. They're known as meat ants. Also, just wanted to thank you guys for the overwhelming support on our new shop. The next goal for us is to release some highly requested Outworlds. And with the recent addition of a laser cutting machine to our workshop, we're excited to announce we'll soon be adding in a new range of acrylic nests as well. So, lots to come, stay tuned. As always, thanks for watching this video, and I hope you enjoyed it.